Hello, my friends. I hope that you can hear me. If you can hear me and if you can see me, sorry, let me try to do it like this. Please, if you can hear me good, if you can hear me very well, please write down something in comments that, hello Alexi, I'm here, I can hear you, everything is fine, because this is my, actually this is my first online video, so I might do some stupid things and something always can go wrong. Yeah, thank you Phil Simpson, thank you Dale Tamura, thank you Nazar, thank you Christian, thank you. Thank you very much, everybody. I think we have actually we planned some minutes at the beginning of the stream for checking everything. So we are still waiting for Dmitry Tkachev. Just a moment. I will try to. I have to do it from my cell phone because I'm too stupid. I failed to do it from my laptop. I will. Actually, I can try to do it from my laptop right now. I hope. Or I don't hope. Sorry. Thank you. Wow, Mother Nature's chameleons are also here with us. Yeah, I remember some of people from it on Herpeton. Thank you. But actually my operating with my electronic devices have nothing to do in common with the war situation, so yes, to some extent I'm not very smart. So we are waiting for Dmitry for several minutes now, and we will start. By the way, I will repeat this information for several times during our stream. All the information about the credentials where you can send your financial support are in the description of the event. So whether it is a PayPal or information for bank transfer, doesn't matter. You can find it in the description of the event. During the video, you are very welcome to write your questions right in the comment section. And yeah, hello Cam. We will try to answer all your questions. Anyway, everything that you want to know about herpetoculture project during war, I hope that we will give you all the answers, because this is actually an unprecedented experience, and personally I don't know any examples of such situations in the world. I hope that our situation will be the only one, and nobody will experience what we experienced in the very first days of the war. So I hope that all of you are feeling good. I will try to. By the way, also in the description of the event, you will find the. You will find the links to our Facebook page, BION's Facebook page, and Facebook page of Responsible Herpetoculture Project as we launched it during the war. Actually, we planned it as a side project where we share our information, where we share our manuals, where we share our Responsible Herpetoculture Journal. By the way, all of you are invited to become co-authors or authors with your articles, where you can write any of your experience with keeping breeding of any reptiles. So if you want to do it and if you want to somehow save your experience, I will be happy to assist, and I will be happy to publish your article in our journal. Well, I think that Dmitry will come in several minutes, So probably I think we will start in several minutes. Just a moment. Okay, for I have no idea where Dmitry is, but I hope that he is on his way here. So probably anyway, we planned with a big part where I start telling the story how everything began. So probably let's start, and Dmitry will join us during several minutes. So guys, first of all, I have to say that till the very last minutes, till the very last seconds, we didn't believe that such things, that war can start in the middle of Europe, that the situation of total war is possible at all in modern society, in 21st century, and that we will become part of it. Anyway, so the war scenario that personally I imagined was the escalation of the conflict somewhere in the far east of Ukraine, in Donbas region, and mentally we were prepared for it. But nobody really believed that Kyiv and other cities can be bombed. So personally I know that, for example, a rocket can be sent from one place and targeted to another place. I had no idea that Kyiv can be bombed directly from Crimea, from Belarus, and from even Caspian Sea, as far as I remember. So on 24th of February, all of us were totally shocked. We were totally like kicked off our normal state. We were disorganized. We didn't believe that it is happening right now. Personally, I and my wife Anastasia, we spent first night of the war in the underground parking in a camping. Every single more or less loud noise was thought to be a sound of a rifle or a bomb or a rocket, but when we heard a real explosion of a rocket just above our heads, I hope that none of you will ever experience this. And Dmitry is here. Hello.
Hello.
He is right near me. So both of us will continue the continue the stream. Dmitry, I have already started my part. So this is Dmitry Tkachev, the owner and director of BION Terrarium Center. And for
this
those of you...
Alexey Marushak, Head Research and Development Department.
Yes. The first part we were shocked, we were scared. Everybody is scared at the war. If somebody tells you that he or she is not scared of war, don't believe. Everybody is scared. Sorry, I will close the door.
Because of different voices.
Yeah, because we have a lot of rescued animals in our
facility.
Yeah, so actually now we are not at Bayonne, we are at Exo Ranch complex that is about 30 kilometers from Kyiv. Getting back to what I was telling you about, so the first act that everybody does is saving their lives and lives of their families and children. So at several first days, most of our staff, most of our workers, they were busy evacuating their children, their families to more or less safe places, and this is not. And unfortunately, for the first 5 days of the war, we were unable to reach our facility. And this is the first lesson that everybody should learn. It is that you need to have as possible automated systems of water supply, lighting, everything, heating as possible. Because during first five days of the war, actually, regular Russian army was not in Kyiv. They were going from the north, from Belarus. They were trying to get to the Kyiv from Chernihiv direction, from the east. But Kyiv was already full of military groups of our enemy, the Russians, and heavy rifle strikes were taking place in Kyiv during the very first days. I posted a video of some sort of shooting at night at Bayonne's page. You can look at it. And this shooting took place just 300, 400, maybe 200 meters from Bayonne. And this is a total miracle that nobody got hit. The only person during these 5 days was our guard, who is a real hero, and he took care about the electricity, he took care about water, about heating, and more or less was responsible about everything. And the second miracle is that the electricity and electrical lines were not crushed and they worked properly. So most of our desert species were supplied with enough heat and enough ultraviolet. And we managed to get to Bayonne only on the sixth day of the war, thanks to Dmitry. Yeah, he organized everything, and I pass the word to him to tell what was going on the sixth day of the war.
Thank you. First of all, I want to tell that 2 years ago, in 2020, we had some sad experience which help us right now. It was lockdown. It was working during coronavirus. We also were blocked for the most part of the year, and we make shifts in Bayonne, and to have possibility work with our animals 24 hours. But to understand what is the war, you must feel it. It is a real disaster. At the first days of the war, a lot of people left Kyiv, the capital of Ukraine. As far as I remember, for today, more than 4 million left Ukraine. Yeah. And of course, people were just very afraid of situation, and our employees, our staff members, already some of them left Ukraine with small children, with daughters. And the first day, it was the most complicated period because animals were completely unattended, unattended for five days. It was martial law, it was curfew in Kyiv, and it was a real adventure and rescue adventure to get to work. Some of our employees used 2-3 hours to do this. And Kyiv was blocked. Kyiv was blocked by block post. It was the problems with fuel, with supplies, and many other things.
Yeah. So, and this is the second lesson that we learned from this situation. You have always to have some reserves, some reserve funds, some reserve amount of food preserved to provide to your facility, because during martial law, during curfew, it is a big problem to get, if we talk about herbivorous reptiles, it is a big problem to get fresh greens, to get fruits, vegetable, whatever, because of big problems with logistics. Imagine that in peaceful time, it takes you from 2 to 4 hours to go to market or open air market to buy a lot of food and then to get them back to Bayonne. During martial law, it can take several days because you always get checked on the block posts. You always you are always afraid of your life because even if there are no direct confrontation between two military groups of your soldiers and the enemy soldiers, you can always be hit with a rocket or a bomb. And actually, if you are not in a bomb shelter, nothing will save you, unfortunately, but the luck.
Excuse me.
Yes.
First days we have to go to the basement every hour.
Yeah.
Upon a siren signal.
Yeah, and it consumes a lot of time. So if we talk about herbivorous animals, it is a big problem to get food for them. If we talk about insectivorous animals, the things are, I can't tell if they are worse or better, because during the first 5 days, as we mentioned many times, Yuri, our person who is responsible for insect production, he is a real magician. He produces more than 2 million of crickets per year, and this is not their limit. But production of insects is always, it's like a line. So if something goes wrong in this line, in this chain of acts, the whole production collapses. And if during these 5 days Yuri was unable to get to Bayonne, and nobody and everybody was unable to get to Bayonne, and some crickets they began to like to eat each other because
in
nobody.
In addition, yeah. Yuri lost his mother and his father.
Yeah, unfortunately. Yeah. So after these 5 days, we got a lot of problems with insects because when we start to give food for our animals, we took everything. We took breeding stock, we took found stock, we took the animals, the insects that are of different sizes, and this was complete chaos, unfortunately. And as you know, some lizards will only eat insects of certain size and of certain species, and to grow the insect from a nymph or from an egg to subadult or adult individual, it takes about 1 month to grow it from egg to imago. And if everything collapses, so in several days you have nothing to eat. Fortunately now, because Yuri managed to got to work, I think after 2 weeks of this situation, because most of us live on the left side of Dnieper, and BION is situated on the right side of Dnieper, and most of the bridges are blocked, so you can't use them to get to work, to cross the river. The underground doesn't work, metro stations that doesn't work, because they are served as bomb shelters.
Just a bomb shelter.
Yeah, municipal transport doesn't work because it is dangerous inside the city, and all time that you can use to go even by foot, by feet, is like from 9 o'clock or 8 o'clock or 8 a.m. to, as far as I remember, 6 p.m. So you are very limited with the time.
And still the war is continuing.
Yeah, and the war is still continuing.
Nobody sees the end.
Yeah, and nobody sees the end. So when we managed to reach BION, the first thing was to decide what should we do. Either we should stay or we should leave. We made a compromise decision.
To split the risks.
Yes, to split the risks, because at any time BION could be bombed and everything would be lost, and nobody wanted, and this is normal, it's natural, nobody wanted to... Yes, Yuri is amazing, Raquel, you're right, he is.
Tell please that we are located in downtown.
Now.
No, yes, in Kyiv. Yeah. BION building is located in downtown.
Ah, yeah.
BION. That is why it is quite a risky place.
Yes. Well, and we decided the following thing. We evacuated all our breeding stock and all our babies of Uroplatus. So all leaf-tailed geckos, because they are, yeah, as Dmitry tells, they are the most delicate animals. And this was like, this was a very risky thing, because as you know, Uroplatus are very gentle animals and they need a very gentle care. And another advantage of it was that me, my wife Anastasia, and another person of our staff, called, his name is Max, we also evacuated from Kyiv, and we evacuated to the village that is just two villages from here. So we are quite close here, and we can take care about the animals that are evacuated. So this is what happened. We separated our collection into two groups. One was one with the most gentle animals was evacuated to Exo Rancho, to a country, to the countryside, and the
another part of him stay and works at BION.
Yes, mainly desert species, and Dmitry will tell us.
I just want to stress that we have quite a special and unique collection. We gather for decades, maybe for 30 years. There are about, right now we lost, unfortunately we lost a part of our stock, about 60 leaf-tailed geckos, spiny tail lizards. We lost all stock of Phrynosoma asio, but still we have around 1,900 of breeding stock, around 70 species, mainly lizards. And I want also to tell that some species were established in herpetoculture due to BION efforts, to BION breeding efforts. The examples are the giant frog-eyed geckos, a few species of leaf-tailed geckos, red-banded spiny-tailed geckos, Parsons chameleons. We got first lot about 20 years ago and breed some successfully. So this is really treasure our collection. The another goal of BION is our team. A lot of people works more than 15 years. Some people works more than 20 years. But anyway, people who works even 3-5 years are professionals. Are people deeply involved in our world, in our this is not just a business, it's our life. So by now we have we need to save our collections, our animals, and to support our people.
Yeah, Simon, thank you for your answer. Thank you for your question. So probably we missed the part where we introduce ourselves. Yes. So this is Dmitry Tkachev. He is the owner and director of BION Terrarium Center. And my name is Oleksiy Marushak. I'm the head of research and development department. Nice
the
to
main
see you.
Important person in scientific research.
Yeah, I hope so. what are the situation? What is the situation now? Currently, the war is continuing, and we still face a lot of problems because our main resource of funds, our main resource of all animals are safe. To some extent, because during the war we can be 100% safe, and I can't claim that tomorrow this situation won't be worse. Thank you. where is that? What we did is a production of healthy captive bred animals. We sell them, we exported them to other countries in big quantities, and I hope that you agree that we are a reputable breeders. But now it is absolutely impossible because no airlines operate in Ukraine, so no airlines no planes can fly to or from Ukraine. Because it is very dangerous, and nobody wants the repeating of a tragedy from 2014 with the MH17 Boeing that was shut down near the area of anti-terroristic operations and near the area of war. So we can't export animals, we can't receive animals, and all resources that we can use for us are our resources that we collected during
during previous years.
So as Dmitry told you previously, I mean the resources that we collected in 2020, 2021. We nearly ran out of them actually in 2020 during coronavirus pandemic, because we also couldn't send animals and we couldn't receive money. And now we are surviving due to these resources, so reserve funds. They are limited actually, and nobody can tell how long this war will last. 2 weeks, 1 week, 2 months, 1 year, nobody knows. And now we survive only due to our reserve funds and donations of our subscribers. I want to say special thank you to everybody who donated any sum of money, it doesn't matter, because during previous years we depleted
our sources due to coronavirus.
Yes, and we did everything to share our experience, to share information. We answered every single question that was asked about keeping, breeding, maintaining, curing, treating, whatever, our animals. And this time we saw real support from you, from our subscribers, partners, friends, strangers.
Like-minded people. Both moral and financial.
Yes.
Both are very important.
Yes.
Let me tell a few words about our survival plan. Anyway, we are in a position to survive, And we have a certain plan for this. First of all, of course, we will optimize all our budget. And another thing, we need to find new sources to survive. The first source is our online project, namely Responsible Herpetoculture Project. We started it 1 year ago and launched in the middle of the war zone on March 31st this year, 31st of March. We strongly hope that this source should be interesting, helpful, useful for all herps community. The president of our project is Philip Devojoli. I think that this person do not need any introduction. And we have top level experts and hope to make a board of experts soon. So we launched this project like educational, research and informative platform to advocate herpetoculture. We strongly hope that you like this project, that you joined this project and support us and herpetoculture by this way. Another thing, we want to produce and distribute merchandise under the brands of BION Terrarium Center and Responsible Herpetoculture Project. We are planning to sell it online. We are planning to sell it at reptile shows in different countries. Fortunately, by now we have full support from our colleagues in United States and Japan concerning this matter. The representative in European Union country is very welcome. Despite wartime, we still running our research. At the end of March, we just published first significant scientific article on leaf-tailed geckos, Uroplatus fantasticus, in Zoodiversity Biological Magazine. Other publication, both on herpetoculture and herpetology, are in process. So we do not want to stand with outstretched hand. We want to be on use. You want to be effective part of our community. And we'll be happy, as Alexei already said, we will be happy to share our experience, just want to understand it in what ways you want to see, like webinars, like streams, live streams, video manuals, etc.
Yes. Exactly. I'd like to add some points. Currently we are asking for financial support because this is basically almost everything. It is absolutely necessary for us to survive, to save our collection and to continue operating. I will tell a couple of words about our Responsible Herpetoculture Project. So the link is in the description. You can go to the site and see what we have there. So basically, this resource is for you to advocate responsible herpetoculture. So we gathered, and I tried to add new articles. We gathered a lot of articles from the internet. All of them are with the free access, so we don't steal anything. We are not violating any laws. They are with free access, but they are gathered on our website, and if you need something to read about positive aspects of herpetoculture, about medical matters, about any types of RH proactivity, you can go to the to our site and
about conservation.
Yeah, about conservation.
Your achievements and in husbandry and breeding.
Yes. So you can read it on our page. It is absolutely free. But some of the sections of our web site are available only for some level of subscription. The lowest level is about $99 per year. So for $99, you can see the...
You can easily check all conditions.
Yes, all like free content. And you will get the access to our first issue of Responsible Herpetoculture Journal and to full versions of our manuals, where we represent all the information that we collect from our animals. So the breeding things, the things about, all the information about winter dormancy, about mating, about incubation, about raising of juveniles, everything is collected in that manuals. But these manuals are available only for the first part of subscription. I think that $100 for the whole year is not that much. And personally, I will do my best to make this resource renewable, to make it alive, to make it interesting for you.
Also, when doing our research, we stay in touch with many specialists, many experts worldwide, like Sebastian Gehring in Germany, like Michael Pupinc in Latvia, with senior searcher in researchers in Ukraine, in Netherlands, and many other countries. This makes us really strong. We can share the ideas, and we could understand the modern level of knowledge. So thank you very much for your close cooperation anytime.
Thank you, Simon. You can go to the website via a link that is in the description of the event. It's responsibleherpetoculture.com.ua. We also made several posts about it on BION's page. And in the menu, in the upper part of the site, you will see the button membership. Just click on it and choose the level of membership that you can that you want to do, or sponsorship. Yeah, if you choose the first, as far as I remember, the first level of membership, just click it, pay the mentioned sum, and feel free and enjoy the things that are payable.
And please follow us on BION Terrarium Center Facebook page, and you will see all news.
Yeah, of course, guys. We are headliners of this evening. If you have any questions, any specific questions, any special questions that you always afraid to ask about war, you can ask them in the comments, and we will answer it. Don't forget about it. What can I also add?
We are here.
We are still continue operating. To our surprise, some of our leaf-tailed geckos that were transferred here already started to lay eggs, and it is highly likely that even this breeding season will be probably not excellent, not super good, but quite good for us to be proud of it in the end of the year. I really hope so. Thank you, Lindsay. Now I would like to maybe stop and tell more about how we lost 60 or 60 plus something leaf-tailed geckos. Please, might have some of you in critical situation. So, as you remember, for 5 days the animals didn't receive any water. It was a really big surprise for me that they survived. It was a big surprise for me that they survived, And Uroplatus species are quite sensitive and they are very sensible to stress. So even when
and for dehydration.
So even if we transfer them from one laboratory to another, we always have problems with shedding, with subsequent inflammation of skin between the old skin and the new skin.
With stress and adaptation.
Yes, and you can imagine how dehydrated animals felt during the translocation from one from one place to another. So the main problem was that during dehydration, and special thanks to our friends from Czech Republic, Anna
and Martin
and Marvin, yeah, Anna and Marvin, who helped us a lot with the treatment, giving us advices and trying to figure out what happened with the collection. So when the animals were dehydrated, they got so-called micro damages of the skin. They are not visible with the naked eye, and we couldn't do anything with this actually. And when we keep the take the animals to another place, take them here, the first thing that we did was the hydration of them. So watering them, try to make some injections of Ringer solution, Rehydron, and etc. This was logical, but this led to the widening of the skin, and all these micro damages, they became bigger, and it also led to problems with shedding. So in the next day, Craig, thank you very much. We completely forgot about it. Let me just finish my thoughts, and Dmitry will tell you everything.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And after that, we got a lot of problems with shedding in all Uroplatus, and unfortunately, not all animals made it, and some of them died, unfortunately. And now, answering Craig's question about Sergei and Nelly, this is particular story.
Yes.
This is about Dmitry.
Just want to inform everybody that we have other department, close partnership in Kharkiv, in another big Ukrainian city, former Ukrainian capital. And our friend, colleague, and key partner is Sergei Prokopyev, who runs this facility, who is a prominent, very skillful breeder. At first, he is breeder of chameleons. Unfortunately, it is real trouble and disaster. His village and his building with animals is located in shelling zone, in military zone, for 47 years from now. Could you imagine? Sergei was abroad and he come back in Kharkiv at the first day of the war. But he still cannot get to him home because his home in a strict restricted zone, shelling zone. Even he want to jeopardize and take all risk, he cannot get to his house because it is restricted military zone with shelling from both sides, from from Ukrainian army and from occupants. But his wife Nelly stay with animals all these 47 days. She has no electricity. She has gas, she has a big problem with getting water because she must go out of house. Could you imagine with all this shelling? 2 days ago, the neighboring house was simply destroyed. And it was a possibility to leave this village through green, so-called green corridor. But Nelly refused to leave the house. She refused to leave the animals. This is a real responsible herpetoculture.
I think this is the top responsible herpetoculture.
We can only pray for Nelly to survive. We keep the line with Sergei every time. He have problems with mobile connection with Nelly, but still he could connect. This is a story for today.
Yes, and for today, unfortunately, the things didn't change. So even the occupants left Kiev, Chernihiv, Sumy, and Zhytomyr regions, they are still present in Kherson, Kharkiv, Luhansk and Donetsk and Zaporizhia regions. Nelly is a real hero. As Dmitry said, she refused to leave the house until there are at least one alive animal in the house. For you to understand, Sergei Prokofiev and Nelly are probably not the biggest, but one of the biggest producers of veiled chameleons, ocellated lizards, crested geckos and blue-tongued skinks, probably not in the world, but in Europe definitely.
But Sergei, main passion is chameleons.
Yeah.
He breed about 12 species during his career.
Yeah.
Another remarkable thing, Sergei and Nelly are both the best propagators of chameleon parson conservation in the wild. You can watch three movies by yes. Sergei and Nelly on our website.
Yes.
And they make a lot for conservation of this amazing chameleon species ex situ.
Yes, if you want to see all three parts of their movie, you can go again to Responsible Herpetoculture Project website, go to conservation section, and all three movies are uploaded there in the section about conservation of Kaluma parsony. Thanks again, Craig, for your question.
Even by now, we are planning to increase our life food laboratory,
yes,
for Sergei purposes, and in any case they are welcome to stay with us to make business here, and we will do all our best to support them.
Yeah, of course. And anyway, if Sergei and Nelly need any support, we will provide everything that we can, from money transfers to feeding insects.
By the way, editing. Sergei is also a part of our responsible herpetoculture project team.
Yeah, of course. The other thing, by the way, as far as I remember, till now, they have 55 or so, or something like that. 55 newborn skinks.
Yes.
During the war.
Blue-tongued skinks during the war.
Yeah, and this is amazing, and Nelly keeps taking care about them.
And because they are very limited in fuel, they use electricity generator for 2 hours only. Could you imagine, they have a lot of newborn wild chameleons. And they use a bottle with warm water to heat their animals.
Actually, I can't understand how can she heat the whole laboratory with bottles with hot water.
Because
this is amazing.
She still has a gas.
Yeah, I know, but
and a lot of small plastic bottles.
And she just put the bottles inside the terrarium, then back.
Frankly speaking, I don't know the details.
I hope that when everything ends, when we win this war, we will do the another several streams, probably, I hope, with Nelly too, and she will tell everything from inside, because we were scared here because we are near the city of Vasilkiv, mm-hmm. one of the cities where an oil station was bombed, an airport was bombed, everything was bombed, so we can just go out and see the rockets flying above our heads. But at least for now, it ended. And in Kharkiv, it is the matter of every single day. Bombs, rockets, rifles, etc.
I think for today, they are most important person in Parson Chameleon's propagation. Craig Darbin breeding, Piotr Nechas research, and Sergei Prokofiev propagation. All these people know each other, and we strongly hope that they could make very a lot of good things all together.
Yes, definitely. I think that this will be the matter of the nearest future. Anyway, continue your questions. Don't be shy. What else can we say? Besides losing some, so this 60 plus leaf-tailed geckos, we lost also about 20 Xenogammas, entire breeding stock of Phrynosoma asio. Some of the animals actually were in winter dormancy, so they didn't require any food, anything, so just water. And this also helped us a lot, because we had like 2 weeks of more or less free time. Not actually not a free time, but the 2 weeks where when we had less animals than we could, because they were sleeping. And the same thing is for Sergei Prokopyev's animals. Some of them were in winter dormancy, and this also helped. Everything now is as follows. So almost all our staff are now working at BION successfully due to enormous efforts of Ivan Niishko. You remember him.
BION senior keeper.
Yes, BION senior keeper. And other staff. And other staff of BION. Currently everything is more or less normal. So. Our leopard geckos began to lay eggs. Our Ruplatus geckos also began to lay eggs. Nephurus levis started laying. Even Teratoscincus kaiserlingi that we purchased from Roger Rocks earlier, even they laid their first eggs, and I hope that we will see some babies very soon. Why Phrynosoma asio died? I have no idea. I think that the same thing is.
It was old group.
Yeah, it was an old group, and mm-hmm. old animals are always more they are weaker. They are less adaptable to extreme conditions. Again, several days without water. I can only guess. That there was for some hours there was a switch off of the electricity, and it was too much for them, unfortunately. I think that it's a combination of factors: dehydration, their age, and temp shock. Thank you very much, Jason. Mm-hmm. Another advertisement. So everybody is welcome to publish their articles.
It
about...
is another form of cooperation.
Yeah, another form of cooperation.
First of all, we introduce everybody to check our project, to see our journal, and to contribute. Phil Gloss, who is a very good promoter, told that the main problem of herpetoculture today is the lack of proactivity. It is completely true. By the way, We want to show you some examples of our merch.
Yeah.
Yes, this is the Max. BION Mark.
Yeah, and this is responsible herpetoculture.
And responsible herpetoculture mark. This is Ukrainian t-shirt. T-shirt dedicated to Ukrainian herpetoculture.
Actually, not herpetoculture, herpetofauna.
Herpetofauna, yeah. Sorry, herpetofauna. Yes, if you check shop section on the responsible herpetoculture website, you can see different types of t-shirts. Some for leaf-tailed geckos fans, some to spiny-tailed geckos fans. They are created by very skillful artists, and we made all this production with great passion.
Hello, Kevin. Nice to see you here.
Hi, Kevin.
Yeah. I think that in the nearest future we will organize the distribution of the t-shirts. I don't remember pockets, mugs, etc. On the reptile shows worldwide, we have some people that are ready, that are already ready to help us with this. One of them is in the comment section. I will not make spoilers. I hope that you will.
Hello, Efrain.
And I hope that you will like them and find them probably on the nearest reptile show.
And please tell us what kind of interaction you expect from us. It helps us a lot.
Yes, don't be shy. You can write down any suggestions that you have, any questions, anything that you want us to help you with, any source of information. You can write them in direct message to our email somewhere on BION's page, anywhere, and we will do our best to help you. I think that in the nearest future we will set up such streams as the regular thing. Sorry for the quality, because this is our first stream.
It was
stream.
Just a repetition.
Yeah, it was just
and
a repetition.
Please check our list of experts and breeders. It is very good company to join.
Yeah. Some of them are again in this chat.
Yes.
I think that next time we will do more with Zoom conference, Zoom online conference, so where everybody can connect using just a link, just a Zoom link. And I hope that we will make it a regular thing. Tomorrow we are going to BION. We will see how things goes there.
And you can expect a special publication about BION during the wartime in the second issue of Responsible Herpetoculture Journal.
Yes, something like that. Okay, guys, I think that it is just 1 hour how long we are talking here. It was our pleasure to see you here. I hope that next time we will have broader audience, more of you. Actually we have a YouTube channel, but
hi Antonio.
We can try several options, so where we like it better. So we can do an online conference in Zoom, record it and then upload it to YouTube channel, so something like this. We will figure it out. Thank you very much for your questions. Thank you very much for your interactions and for your support. Please, if you want to help us, you can again make financial donations. You can spread the information. You can share it wherever you want. And pray for Ukraine. We stay strong. We stay safe. And we will survive.
And we will win victory anytime.
Yes. Thank you very much.
No doubt.
Goodbye.
Thank you.